There was a time when energy was a scary word. One among a full load. Meltdown. Contamination. Liquidators. Iodine. Entire regions evacuated. Cities in brownout. Growing greenhouse effect. Where are we now? How do we make the world so much better? Right now, we're the largest producer of energy in the world. The energy of thorium. Today, Alvin Weinberg's dream, the man who devoted his entire life to a different nuclear power, has become reality. Thorium molten salt reactors supply the energy needs of nearly 70% of the planet. No melting down, no explosion, no waste. The green atom. A single thorium sphere the size of a ball can deliver one person's lifetime needs of electricity. Who would have thought? All the energy we ever needed, right under our feet. Thorium, the energy of the future.
Well, no. It's a little more complicated than that. Of course, most official histories focus on the commercially successful systems. In the US, Europe, Japan, this would be the light water reactor, LWR. Although I was much involved in the earliest days of LWR, most of my efforts for the first decade of the nuclear era were devoted to reactors that did not become commercial. In some cases, the failure was technical. In other cases, the technology was adequate, and the failure was political or economic. Yet, indeed, as I look back, I must place one of those failures, the molten salt reactors, as one of our most important scientific contributions.
Still further in our future, another avenue of reactor research has led to the molten salt reactor experiment.
Every now and then, people keep coming back to the idea because it's such an attractive idea. Now, if you want to make your own opinion rather than swallowing some ad, I need some time if you're ready. The facilities where I've been working a major part of my life as nuclear researcher and laboratory director were created in Oak Ridge, Tennessee in late 1943 during the United States super secret World War II project to construct an atomic bomb. In fact, I should say that the original reactors were built to produce plutonium for bombs.
In the early 1940s, the priority of the Manhattan Project had nothing to do with the eventual creation of safe and efficient nuclear power. It had everything to do with the production of materials for nuclear weapons. There seemed to be no connection whatsoever between nuclear reactors that produce energy and nuclear weapons. What happened with the discovery of plutonium-239 was a bridge was made between these two ideas. And it became clear that plutonium could be produced in a nuclear reactor as uranium was fissioning, and this plutonium could be extracted, purified, and also used in a nuclear weapon.
At Oak Ridge, Tennessee, are two of the giant plants where the atomic bomb is produced. A 59,000-acre military area, a city where 75,000 people worked in absolute secrecy on history's most sensational secret.
My group was charged with the design of the plutonium-producing reactor for the Manhattan Project. We cut whatever corners there were. And one of the most important corners was that the only way to make the reactor operate with that limited amount of uranium we had was to build it in a way that subjected it to the same kind of instability. This meant that if the water were to suddenly disappear, as a result, say, of a massive failure of the water pumps, the pile would become supercritical and blow up. This happened at Chernobyl 45 years later. But during the war, we were so intent on getting something that produced plutonium that such issues simply didn't emerge.
Then one night, in the solitude of the New Mexico desert country, the awesome release of energy was achieved. Crossed the threshold of the atomic era. The violent release of energy had been the first purpose, but there was another, even more important, to control this power and put it to work in the service of mankind.
Check.
Check.
I'll raise.
So this was fooling the public in a way that it was a rigged poker game. They were telling the public that, you know, the benefits of nuclear power, the benefits of the atom being split, the concentration was on what it could do in the peaceful sense. And in the background, always, of course, was this great lumbering machine going on producing more and more nuclear warheads.
The atom bomb, spreading its mushroom cloud over Bikini Atoll in 1946, gave scientists and fighting men the opportunity to learn about the most destructive force yet devised by man. But a bomb is atomic energy uncontrolled after its release. And men of science knew that the same energy kept under control might serve the Navy in a vastly different way.
In 1946, the Army's Manhattan Engineer District invited selected men from the armed forces and private industry to Oak Ridge to explore this future utilization of atomic power. Courses were given in basic nuclear physics.
Many of these early visitors to Oak Ridge became leaders of the American development of nuclear energy. Among them were people from Westinghouse and Hyman Rickover. Captain Rickover arrived with his half dozen naval lieutenants and lieutenant commanders to investigate the feasibility of nuclear energy for naval propulsion.
Nuclear fission produces a lot of energy in a relatively small volume. We want to remove this thermal energy away from the fuel and ultimately convert it into electricity. And so there is a cooling system, a cooling circuit, which brings a coolant through the fuel in the core. The coolant heats up in the core, removes the heat from the fuel, and then either exchanges it with another circuit or directly into the turbines, converts it into electricity.
In these early days, we explored all sorts of power reactors, comparing the advantages and disadvantages of each type. The number of possibilities was enormous, since there are many possibilities for each component of a reactor. Fuel, coolant, and moderator. By the way, a moderator is the material that slows down neutrons emitted by fission to speeds at which they can better see the next nucleus to hit, and thereby sustain the nuclear chain reaction. Now, imagine the fissile material may be uranium-233, uranium-235, or plutonium-239. The coolant may be water, heavy water, gas, or liquid metal. And the moderator may be water, heavy water, beryllium, graphite, or in the fast neutron reactor, no moderator. I have calculated that if one counted all the combinations, one could identify about 1,000 distinct reactors. Thus, at the very beginning of nuclear power, we had to choose which possibilities to pursue, which to ignore.
Hey.